Hey, what's going on, guys? In this video, we're going to take a look at this Korth Mongoose 4-inch barreled revolver, the be-all, end-all of all wheelies out there. All right, now, you revolver fans, don't get all pissed off, get into a tizzy in the comment section. This is just my opinion. We're just going to have some fun with this. I truly do believe this is probably one of the finest revolvers out on the market today. But again, this is just an opinion, so don't freak out and start trying to, you know, oh, I know more than, oh, well, that's how it always happens, I guess. But like I said, let's have some fun and take a look at this revolver more closely. For now, let me just leave it on the stand right here while I kind of talk out loud. So the first time I ever heard of a Korth revolver was probably back in 2013, I believe. And that was a time where I was heavily into revolvers. Okay, and I was shooting at the range with a 686, I believe, and I met up with this group of older gentlemen that I dubbed the Wheel Gun Crew. Now, these guys were really into their revolvers. They had tons of revolvers, like so many. They would bring them out, and I was like, wow, there must have been like 80 revolvers amongst all of them. And they were giving me tips, tricks, thoughts, advice, how to fight with a revolver, how to reload, all this good stuff. And I learned quite a bit from some of these people. And one individual in particular owned a Korth revolver, which I had never heard of. He had something called a combat revolver, the Korth combat revolver. And I was like, what is that, a python? He's like, oh, no, don't call it a python. You know, Willie Korth would be pissed. And I was like, who? What the hell are you talking about? And he went on to give me the whole history about Korth revolvers. You know, the company came into existence in the mid-50s or something. He went through his whole story. He was really into it, the history. And I thought that was kind of interesting, but I was like, I never heard of this company. He's like, it's from Germany. I'm like, oh. And that piqued my interest a lot because I do like German stuff. From automobiles to appliances like vacuum cleaners, the Miele, to dishwashers, anything Bosch, you know, to guns, of course, Heckler & Koch. So when he said that, I'm like, oh, a German revolver, huh, interesting. But that's as far as it went at that time. He let me look at his Korth combat, and, you know, to be honest, the other time, I was like, yeah, it looks really nice, but I didn't think anything of it. I like the Smith & Wesson. Fast forward to around year 2016-ish, I think it was, when there was a lot of talk about Nighthawk Custom, you know, pairing up with Korth. And I was like, wait a minute, that name again. That sounds familiar. I'm like, what? So I think it was around 2016. And then 2017, a lot of online chatter about Nighthawk being the sole importer of Korth revolvers. So that really piqued my interest. I started looking, you know, reading up on this and looking at all the pictures of the Mongoose series. And I was like, wow, that is a really nice looking revolver. And just the allure of it being maybe a custom revolver, per se. So at that time, you know, I was like, wow, I would like to, like, check that thing out. But of course, no gun shop locally had even heard of this revolver, this brand. They're like, what is it? I'm like, it's a Korth. They're like, what? Nobody knew about it. So it kind of just fell off by the wayside, and I was like, eh, whatever, it's a pretty pricey gun. I was really into Wilson Combat 1911s, and I was like, how could you, you know, get something like that over a Wilson? So I kind of just let it go. And it wasn't until probably 2019 at the gun club, I met another individual who I still talk to today that had this specific Mongoose, but in the 6-inch version. And I was like, oh my God. You got a Korth? He's like, oh yeah, I just got it. I was like, oh my, oh, can I look at it? And he's like, yeah, sure. And I was looking it over in the flesh, and I couldn't believe it. And I was just looking the whole thing over, and I was so impressed with this revolver. When I tried that double action trigger, I was like, what? What? I couldn't believe it. Then I started shooting. He let me shoot it. He so graciously let me fire a bunch of 38 specials through it. It was so damn accurate. I couldn't believe it, and it was effortless. Like, I was like, what? I was just having such a great time. I was like, this is an incredible revolver. He's like, yeah, put some mags through it. I'm like, really? He's like, yeah. So he let me do 6 rounds of magnums through it. It was such a joy to shoot. I just kept looking at it, and I'm like, I gotta get me this. I gotta get one of these. And at that time, I think he told me, he's like, yeah, it took me a while to get one. I don't know if they were hard to get in 2019, but he said it took him like maybe over 2 months to get it or something like that. and the price point, you know, it's a very, very pricey revolver. But then again, you know, I like Wilson Combat 1911s. I did dabble with Nighthawks, and it's kind of up there. Yeah, so that kind of, you know, for a revolver, I was like, I don't know, man. But I was taken aback when I was able to actually shoot an actual mongoose, you know, in the flesh. So in 2019, I just wasn't into guns. I know that sounds strange. And I had a lot of other things going on in life. So it kind of fell by the wayside. Again, I was like, I would have to trade in this or sell that. And it's too much effort. Forget it. And I just let it go, even though I really wanted one. Fast forward to late 2022, where I just decided, you know what? I haven't gotten something in a long time. I could sell a few guns to fund it, which I did. And I was okay with selling those guns away to get this specific Korth Mongoose 4-inch barrel 357 Magnum revolver. And I am glad I did, because this revolver makes me very happy. So that's just a little bit of background. Now let's take a closer look at this revolver. Remember, this is going to be a long video, by the way. All right, so let's take a closer look at this Korth Mongoose 4-inch. Now, I know a lot of people might say, oh, the Korth Mongoose is an entry-level revolver from Korth, and this and that, well, entry-level, whatever. They're, we'll call them higher-end ones, don't really interest me. I mean, the 8-shot kind of did, but there's too much going on with the rails, and, you know, I like this standard-old-looking revolver right here. It does kind of look like a Python, but I think it looks phenomenal. Come on now. So first, I just want to talk about the grips. These are nil grips, specifically made for this Korth Mongoose because of this cutout underneath there, which I'll talk about later. But it originally did come with Hogue rubber grips, which are coyote ugly, but very functional. But come on, you don't want rubber grips on a revolver like this. It also had another pair of grips or stocks, if you want to call them revolver stocks. I think they're like Turkish walnut, gym something. I don't know. I didn't like them. So I put them on eBay and I was shocked at how much they went for. So I used those funds to buy nil grips for this revolver, which are a lot more functional. The checkering, that's what I like, is checkering on my revolver stocks. And the finger grooves are just right. So, and the thumb can lock right there. Very nice. Let's just take a closer look at this ventilated ribbed barrel, gold bead front sight, full underlug. Check out this reverse crown insert stainless steel barrel here. I mean, it's just these fine little touches that make this revolver just that bit more. You know what I mean? It's just, I like how it juts out like that, where you can see that stainless steel. I like this little sweep right here. It's just attention to detail, like how this is made. Just gives it a little bit of a different look. The sweeping, how this is designed up here. You got the serrated top to cut glare. And this diamond-like carbon coating, incredible. Number one, it's strong as hell. And number two, I think it just looks very sleek and almost, I don't want to say tactical, but modern. Makes it look modern. This finish is tough as nails, because I was told you can pull this trigger 10,000 times and you still won't have a ring around the collar, the scoring mark. And I was like, what? And that seems to be true somewhat, because I've seen used Korths and you still don't see the scoring mark around the cylinder and they're used. Granted, I don't think that many people shoot that many rounds through their Korth or, you know, most revolvers, but I thought that was pretty interesting. So this coating can take a true beating. And plus, like I said, makes it just look really sleek and modern looking. So I don't think bluing would look good on this type of revolver. I mean, it could, but I just like it the way it is right here. So, I mean, just look at that ejector rod, how it meets up with that pinpoint right there to lock in the cylinder. So on this one, I believe the cylinder locks in 3 points. And we can talk about that later. Cylinder release is very unique. It's kind of, I don't want to say it's strange, but that's what this is right here. This is the cylinder release. Everything I'm used to is right here and pushing forward all my life. With the Pythons, you got to pull back. You know, I don't like that, but whatever. I've never really owned a Ruger, which you push in. But this one right here is right over here. Cylinder release is right here. This button right here, you push it forward And watch this. Push it forward. Everything is so tight. I can't explain it. Everything just feels so damn precise and fitted exactly how it should be. No, it's not loose. It's not too tight. Push that. And when you release the cylinder, it feels like it's on ball bearings. Just comes down like that. Just goes up like that. I don't know. There's something about how this is fitted. It's just incredible. So the cylinder, like I said, locks up right up here using the extractor rod up there. And I think it locks right in there. Another, almost like how Smith uses a ball bearing on the frame. See that? I think, focus. I believe it locks up right in there. Let me see. Right there, and that little part right there. Right there. Locks right into this nub, into there, to here. And then, of course, it locks back on this back plate here, the blast plate. I don't know, man. This is just incredible. Everything about this revolver is just making me so giddy. And we all know this button here, you can remove the cylinder by just pressing this button, and this comes out just like that. I did not opt for a 9mm cylinder to be fitted on here because, I don't know, I don't want to shoot 9mm out of my revolver. I have that 986, which I rarely shoot that thing. It just locks right back in just like that. Oh, this thing is awesome. See, I'd rather not take this thing on and off either. But you can if you want to get that fitted 9mm cylinder. Just locks in just like that. Look how tight that is. A little bit of movement, that's okay. But once you roll this trigger, damn, hold that trigger back, it's bank vault locked up. It won't move at all. And that's what you want. That is locked so tight, more than Smith's, more than Performance Center, whatever you want to call it. I just wanted to show you the front of the trigger right here that is highly polished, as you can tell. Look at that. And it's a great feeling to get your trigger finger on there. It's just nicely polished. There is an adjustable trigger stop that I'm not going to mess with. It's already set perfectly. But yeah, the trigger, awesome. Does have target sights. I kind of wished it had the low profile adjustable sight that I saw on this guy's 6-inch, but that's all right. These are target sights. And like I said, gold bead front sight, the hammer. I don't know. This is just I can't explain it, guys. Everything about this gun right here just feels perfect. And it's a revolver of all things. I don't even feel this way about a Wilson Combat 1911, to be honest with you. There's something about this finely tuned, I'm going to call it a custom revolver, that just blows, say, a semi-custom 1911 out of the water. So this double action trigger is so damn smooth. I just can't explain it. It just rolls very smooth, 9 pounds, at least 9 pounds. I don't shoot in single action, but oh, when you do that, everything's so damn smooth. Forget about it. That's crazy. I think the single action is, what, 3 pounds, if that? I was able to take this revolver to an indoor public range for the fun of it. Normally, I do not go to public ranges. I go to clubs. But because I was meeting someone at, you know, a range, I decided to bring this along. And I was only able to shoot 50 rounds of 38 Special through this, as well as only 6 rounds of Magnums. And I will say, this revolver right here, it takes the cake. I mean, I like this revolver more than any, more than my Wilson Combat 1911s, for sure. I don't know what it is. It's something about this revolver having more, I don't know if it's more fun, it's more unique, but I enjoyed shooting this revolver, this specific Korth, more so than any, say, semi-custom 1911 out there. And that's saying a lot. So I did clean this gun up really, 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 really good to kind of put it back to, I don't know, almost new, you know, condition. And I gotta say that this finish is very, very durable because it shows absolutely no type of wear or carbon buildup or anything except for the cylinder face. I did have to clean that up a little bit. You can tell I shot it right there. But other than that, I cleaned up the crown, everything. So having shot this just recently, my experience with doing those 50 rounds, this double action trigger roll is incredible. There's really no stacking And that's, there's a reason why, but I'm telling you right now, this is no other type of double action trigger on a revolver that I have ever experienced. And this is because of something they call a roller design, a roller bearing system. And what that means is there's these different diameter discs that go in here, is the best way I could describe it, that can change the feel of the double action trigger roll, which I think is pretty neat. So I believe there's a size, they call it 5 disc, that's already installed from the factory in here. And with the number 5, it kind of removes the stacking, so it's more just a whoop, like a sweep. So if you use a disc number 1, I believe, or number 3, that's when you can start feeling a more, like it changes the properties of the stacking. You can feel it where it's going to touch off. So I believe I was told disc number 5 is installed in here. So that's a much more like a sweeping motion versus a stacking, motion, I guess, if that's how you want to call it. So basically those discs change the stacking properties. The smallest roller has the heaviest stacking, I believe, with a clear staging point. But they don't include these rollers or these discs because I was told people or the end user would try to install them themselves and screw it up. And then everything gets all messed up in the gun and they end up sending it back to Nighthawk to get readjusted, repaired, what have you. So they don't include the other rollers or discs. So it has a number 5 and it's a sweeping motion and I like it. It's pretty cool. So that's pretty different. That's pretty interesting and different. And you can control and adjust the double action pressure or the mainspring by using a tool that goes right into the bottom of this grip in here and you can decrease, increase. I'm not gonna mess around with that because you could, again, change things, you might have light primer strikes, what have you, but that's something different. You can actually change the mainspring pressure by using a tool by putting up here and adjusting it. You can also adjust, which again, I'm not gonna mess with, by using a screwdriver over here and over here, and you can just adjust it. Again, not gonna mess with it, and again, I'm not gonna mess with the mainspring, but those are the unique features of this Korth revolver. It's very adjustable. All right, so why don't we take a look at what comes in the box here. It's pretty interesting. It's like a shoe box. I don't know, it's kind of different. And in the box, you just get a bunch of paperwork. Got a manual that's in German, but there is English in here. And I read the manuals, very interesting. Here, see, those are the rollers or the discs. See, there's 3 different kinds. Very, very interesting, very unique. And it talks about the sights, you can adjust the target sights with the included, like a screwdriver, you want to call it. Here's the cylinder and yoke. Oh yeah, there's like a spring in there. Yeah, it's kind of cool. It's got a little cutout window and you can see the spring. Here, I'll show it to you. So if you open this up, see that? You can see the spring. There's a little window. You can see the spring in there. Also, I want to just kind of show this to you. If you want to call it the ratchet or the star extractor, yeah, check that out, the star extractor, if you want to call it that. There's a lot of, I can tell that's been hand filed and it readjusted right there. It's pretty amazing. It's just different looking. And when you hit this ejection rod, there's a noticeable stop right there, a little bit of pressure, and then when you hit it, it comes out like that. Look how much beefier that is. Always positive ejection of the casings, but I don't know, that star extractor or ratchet, whatever you want to call it, it just looks really neat and different. Everything about this revolver is just freaking cool. All right, like I said, you got the manual in here. It's got some interesting literature. I don't know, I just think it's pretty neat. Just something in German, of course. You got Nighthawk stuff. Oh, the test target of what this revolver is capable of, just like that. Pretty interesting. And look at this box. It's got this bright styrofoam red, cherry red. You got a little tag here, and here's the screwdriver. I don't know why, you need two of these, basically, to adjust and trigger, but they only give you one. I guess you gotta get the other one yourself. Or you can use this, I guess. This thing here is used to adjust the LPA rear target sight. Maybe you can use these two together in conjunction. And speed loader. Oh, a word about the Korth speed loaders. You actually do have to use one of their speed loaders. I have another one sitting over here to speed load up that revolver, because it's ever so slightly, I don't know, a little different than, say, an L frame or 586, 686 speed loader from 5-star. But that's all that's in the box. There were other grips, like I said, the rubber grips, which you know, I don't need those. I don't even know where I put them. The rubber Hogue grips that look funny on here. And then it came with the Turkish wood grips, which I didn't like at all. And I sold those and used the funds to actually get those nil grips and had some funds left over to purchase some more ammo. So let me just quickly talk about the speed loader here. Okay, so the Korth speed loader kind of looks like a 5-star, all right? I'm sorry, I got this light on. Maybe I should turn the light down. So this is a Korth speed loader. It definitely just looks like a 5-star, and it rotates the opposite direction. I think like an HKS, so it kind of messes me up a little bit. Now I got to learn how to, so the German way is the opposite way. So the way these are spaced are ever so slightly off. And then say this one here that's made for a 586 or 686 six shot. So yeah, I'll show you. Once again, cylinder release is up here. You just go like that, pop it open. This speed loader here, you just drop it in just like that, and you turn it the opposite way that I'm used to, which is this direction. Everything drops in just like that. Now if we use the 5-star, check it out. It'll still drop in, but now I go to the opposite way. But when I release, it doesn't come out as easy. It gets like stuck. See? It's jammed up. And there you go. Now it falls in. I mean, it still works, but it's not smooth like the Korth speed loader, which I thought was made by 5-star, to be honest with you. So that tells me it's ever so slightly a little bit different than a standard old 686 for a speed loader. So, all right, so let's kind of put this back on that stand and let's talk a little more. All right, so basically I give this revolver an A+. It's probably one of the nicest guns I've ever owned, handguns at least. I know that sounds strange, but again, there's something about this revolver that just blows my semi-custom 1911s away. I don't know if it's because anything I touch on this thing, when I'm pushing buttons, when I'm opening cylinders, when I'm doing this and that, rolling the trigger, everything feels so refined and foreign, which tells me I've never experienced a firearm like this ever, you know, in my life. So I think that's pretty cool. And we can just kind of talk about what I know about Korth revolvers. Everything's machined out of billet steel to extremely tight tolerances. Now, granted, they say it's like one gun, one gunsmith. I don't see how that is in today's world. You know, I'm sure there's a lot of CNC machining. I'm sure they outsource a lot of their materials, you know, whatever, what have you. And maybe there is one guy that's kind of putting some stuff together at one point, but I'm sure there's still a team of people that have to work together to get this revolver from start to finish. I think they said they only have about 25 to 30 employees total for the company. So I don't know how many people are working, you know, in the factory actually assembling and putting this thing together. So that would be interesting. You know, some people say that the Mongoose is an entry-level revolver. Well, okay, so be that. Or some people say, well, that will not stand up to like a Manurhin MR73. Well, I actually have access to a Manurhin MR73 that's imported by Beretta. I've shot that thing a lot. I don't own it. It's somebody that I know. And to be honest, I could get one of those, but I like this Korth Mongoose more than the Manurhin MR73. I'm being completely serious here. I have an opportunity to get one still. So who knows? Maybe. But I am going to try to borrow a Manurhin MR73, a new production one that's been imported by Beretta. And we can do maybe in a few months or something, compare it with this one right here. Or who knows? Maybe one will fall in my lap. We'll see what happens. But it's just personal preference, okay? You can call this Mongoose an entry level, but I really, really like it. I like how sleek it looks. And again, I like how it functions. It's pretty incredible. Other than that, I want to end the video now. Let me know what you think about this revolver. And if you have any questions about it, I'll try to answer them. But I think it's a phenomenal revolver. All right, guys, leave some comments below. Let me know what you think. And as always, stay safe and check 360 often. Later.